saw you last night at we were at the People's Choice, the BFCA Awards.
The Critics, yeah.
The Critics' Choice. Uh-huh. And you gave a great speech for Meryl.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. You know, I was thinking today, at one point I actually thought that it was my award, you know? Something happened. I thought I lost my mind there for a minute.
They took it away from you.
Yeah, well, I got a little swelled up there thinking, you know?
Well, those are good moments.
Yeah, those are good moments.
It's a nice thing. This is relatively new for you, being on this particular train, yeah?
Relatively new, very new. I've never done this before.
You never been through the whole cycle? Because I know with Antoine there was talk about you doing stuff. And
you know, I only know about the talk of Antoine Fisher now, which is, what, 5 years later? So I've been initiated, or what they say, baptized by fire.
There you go.
I'd rather be baptized by water, but, you know, it's exciting. It's dizzying, as my husband says. It's overwhelming. It's, I'm still trying to figure out what it all means.
I don't think anybody ever does.
Yeah, exactly. I think when you take away the expectation, you realize that what it means is just what it means, is, you know, people recognizing your work.
Well, there was a lovely lunch today for AFI, which had its own group of 10 films.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just people from, nobody had to get up and give them a speech. Nobody had to win.
Oh,
it was just,
nice.
You know, and there was something very peaceful about that for change.
Yeah, it
during
is.
All this insanity.
I realized last night, I thought to myself, oh, there's a nice piece of salmon on my table with some hummus underneath and great champagne, but I can't drink any of it because it's an awards ceremony. You know, and I have to get
clearly
up and give a speech.
Award.
I may have to give up and give a speech for Meryl Streep because she said, if I win, can you give my acceptance speech, Viola? And, you know, if Meryl Streep says, you know, can you accept my award for me? You say yes. I mean, is there any other answer?
Yeah.
And so I thought, I can't partake of the feast, you know, because I have to give an acceptance speech. And sometimes, even though it's an honor to be nominated for an award, sometimes it can kind of blur the joy a little bit. And, you know, they can.
The threat of losing, or
the threat
of
losing, the threat of losing, even though you don't expect to win. Even though it would be nice to win.
Yeah.
It's kind of one of those very complicated human moments of ego, your ego kind of being deflated when you lose, though you never expect it to win, you know.
Though some people do expect to win. It's kind of fascinating when you hear from people, particularly at the Academy Awards, where they've decided they were going to win.
Well, you know.
They get very angry sometimes.
Yeah. You know, that's the mistake, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
But, you know, what can you do?
Mistake people make. I joined the Viola Davis fan club in about 2002, actually, with the Law and Order episode, with the Criminal Intent episode, where I saw the show, which I watched every week, and went, who the hell was that woman? It was such a powerful performance on that show, and, you know, it was a guest star.
Yeah.
And then you rolled into Far From Heaven soon after.
Yeah.
And it all started to fall in apart.
I have to say that the only people who really love the Law and Order Criminal Intent episode are the people outside of my family. That was one role I did where my entire family, they said nothing.
Huh.
No one in my family liked it.
Because you're so hard, or because?
Well, I think it's because I murdered a family, you know.
Little thing like that.
It's that I murdered a family, especially my mother. She had nothing to say.
Hmm.
You know, she called, I think I called her the next day, and I think I mentioned the Law and Order Criminal Intent, and I think she just grunted.
Motherly support is a beautiful thing.
Yeah, exactly.
So, but Steven Soderbergh had actually found you, because you came up in Solaris. It was pretty quick after all that stuff, but Steven had already had you in a couple movies.
Well, you know, I did Out of Sight with him, and I wish I had a fantastic Steven Soderbergh story, just like I wish I had a fantastic Doubt story.
Mm-hmm.
But Steven Soderbergh noticed me because I auditioned for Out of Sight. My agency put me on tape in New York, and that's when I had really, really big hair. I won't tell you how I got the big hair, But I had really, really, really big hair.
Wait a minute, now you have to tell me how you got the big hair. Now you teased us.
I used to do my hair myself, and I discovered this technique of how to braid these, like, really twisty curls in my hair. The only problem is I was... I didn't know what I was doing, so I put too much hair in. So my hair was like a huge afro. And I had to play this character, and I decided to do it really simply, you know. Mm-hmm. And he said it was the simplicity of how I did it and my big hair that kind of captured his attention, which is actually what you need to do when you put yourself on tape, because mm-hmm. the thing about putting yourself on tape is they can always press the fast forward button or the erase button. Mm-hmm. That's the problem with tape. So I guess, you know, I should use the big hair technique, actually. I should use that as my secret weapon. But anyway, that's how he cast me.
Are you good with auditioning? Do you like auditioning?
I can't stand auditioning. I don't like auditioning. The only time I really enjoy auditioning is when the role is so fantastic and just you feel mm-hmm. it has your name tattooed on it. That's the only time it's a joy. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes there are just those characters that just take very little effort. Mm-hmm. You know, it's almost like you've been waiting for the role your whole life. Rolling Seven Guitars is like that for me, mm-hmm. August Wilson play. But then there are other roles that just require a lot of effort. Mm-hmm. If they're not written well, because you don't want to comment on them, and also you're kind of pissed off because mm-hmm. once again your ego gets in the way and you think, I'm better than this, don't you see I'm better than this? Mm-hmm. And so you have to quiet all those voices and mm-hmm. get down to being an actor, because if they see that in an audition and they can see mm-hmm. the commentary on the role, then your audition is gonna suck. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes it's those roles that are really small. Mm-hmm. And you just want to say, give me the damn job. Just give mm-hmm. it to me. And, you know, it's occupational hazard, though. You know, going into a room and finding out what they want. Mm-hmm. And if they have any imagination to see you in anything different. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of guessing in the business. You know, part of the kind of attraction to the business is mm. the fact that it's kind of nebulous. Mm. That you can't put your finger on what's going to work in the business. Mm-hmm. What is going to be the one thing that's going to work, that's going to get me working as an actor, that's going to get me the job? Mm-hmm. As soon as someone says, well, it's you got to just lose some weight, then you lose some weight, that doesn't work. Mm-hmm. You know, and then some people will say, maybe it's just, you know, young people. If you're young, it works. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, you're young, you get out of school, you know, at 20-something years, that's not working, you mm-hmm. know. And then you think, oh, maybe it's your hair. You know, mm-hmm. maybe my hair is too ethnic.
So make it,
I made it big, you know. I was living in New York at the time. In L.A., you don't make your hair big, but... you know, then you think of all these formulas that's going to work, that's going to capture their attention, that's going to make them see you. And you don't know what's going to work. Mm. You have no idea. It's like a game of chance in this business. You know, talent and hard work mean everything and nothing. It really does. Youth. Yeah. Nothing.
Yeah. Well, I sometimes think that people who actually are working and have established themselves, you know, people who are considered stars or uprising mm-hmm. stars, are still figuring out what that thing is, that nebulous thing that they don't really know about until
Absolutely.
They've seen it in five or six roles. The people who are really more, less character actors and more star types.
Oh, you know,
absolutely. There's that thing that draws you to them.
Absolutely.
But do they know?
No, they don't know. But then you have the actresses like the Cloris Leachmans or the Sally Fields or the Jessica Langs or the Ellen Bernsteins. You know, the names go on and on of the people who came into the business. Sally Field, I think, came in Gidget, right?
Yeah.
Cloris Leachman, Jessica Lange, and, you know, Ellen Bernstein came in as beauty queens.
Yeah.
They weren't actresses. So what if they said, you know what, you just want to see my cuteness? But they didn't settle for that. At some point, they said, okay, we have to go back to school. Sally Field said that, actually. We're going to go back to school, and we want to be serious actors. We want to be we want to play complicated roles. Mm-hmm. We want to learn a technique. And they did it, and all of a sudden, you see Sally Field go from Gidget to what? Norma Ray.
Yeah.
And Cloris Leachman, Last Picture Show. You know, Ellen Burstyn, you know, look at her career. Right. So sometimes you can't put a finger on it. Sometimes it does morph. You can morph into something else, and people allow you to do that.
Yeah.
And then other times, you know, you have someone like Julia Roberts who did the maid role, the Irish maid, and the Jekyll and Hyde thing.
Yeah.
You know, which is, you know, I respect that. You know, she did it because she said, you know, I just don't want to be romantic comedy actress anymore. But people didn't receive it.
Yeah.
You know, they
want to break out of it.
Yeah, they want her to be their sweetheart.
Yeah.
So once again, nebulous. You just can't put a finger on it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
Well, it's funny, we were talking about Milk the other day and an amazing performance by Sean Penn, and how do you compare that performance to, you know, Spicoli 20 years ago, or
the
Falcon and the Snowman or something. He's been a great actor this whole time, but
absolutely,
he's a different person. He's not the same, you know, it's not the same things that he's working with. He's found new
tools. Well, yeah, he's an actor, you know. Yeah. Some people, Meryl Streep, certain people are just known, Philip Seymour Hoffman, they're just known as actors.
Yeah.
So that's the great thing. They can do anything and people will say, that's fantastic, because that's what they're known for. Yeah. There's no one stamp on them, but what, they represent 0.0001% of the profession. I mean, the rest of us are just crawling in there like slogs, you know, trying to get our little piece of the cake.
So what made you decide to become an actress in the first place? What was your evolution?
I don't know. You know, I keep saying the same story.
Yeah.
Here's the one thing. I keep saying the same story, and at some point I thought to myself, am I full of shit? You know, when you talk this much, you really are full of shit. I'm full of shit. You know, I said I decided to be an actress when I saw Cicely Tyson do Autobiography of Miss Jane Pittman. You know, because frankly, she was a black woman. I hadn't seen that before. She looked like my mother, dark skin, full lips, afro, aging from 15 to 105. And I thought, I want to do that. It's magic. It's a craft. It's not Sanford and Son. I mean, even though that was fantastic. But, you know, that's why I decided to become an actress. But along the way, it changes. And somewhere along the way, the reason changed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that I'm too ashamed to say it, but I felt like I didn't have any other choice. I didn't see anything else that I was really great at. And I don't really particularly feel I'm great anyway. So it kind of started off as just a passion, a dream. Wow, that's fantastic. And then I got this period where I was always had stage fright, always crying and panicked every time I was in front of people, and I thought, this is not what I'm supposed to do. And then I really, you know, got to college and thought, I'm too afraid to be unemployed. So I don't want to be an actor, you know, and then I decided.
It's a daring profession.
Yeah.
It's scary out there.
Then I started to try to explore other things and nothing else worked. So I was like, you know, I might as well go for it.
Did it feel natural when you did the work? I mean, if you were scared to go on stage is one thing, but when you were on stage, even in high school, I guess, did it feel right?
Yeah. It does feel right. It does feel right. I mean, I don't mean to sound confusing. When you talk to most actors, they will tell you, this is what I've always wanted to do. I love acting, and I do love acting. But it's like any commitment. You have periods where you fall out of love with it.
Mm-hmm.
And along your journey as an actor, there's so many moments you fall out of love with it that you wonder, you forget why you wanted to do it, and you wonder if this was really what you meant to do, but basically it is a love, I guess. I think along the way I've questioned the commitment.
So do those moments of questioning come when you're doing work that's not as interesting, or do they come even when you're doing particularly interesting stuff?
They come when I'm not doing things that are interesting. They come when I'm doing something interesting, I think, and it's not received well. They come when the business strangles my love of it. Those are the moments that it comes and you forget why you love it. You do. And sometimes the memory lapse can last a long time. And then you think, okay, there's got to be something else that's going to come in it that just comes in my life that's going to wake me up in the morning. That's the journey of an actor, though. I guess that's what it is.
Well, I think when anything you love becomes a job, it hurts. It doesn't have that same... And, you know, when you... I mean, obviously, a lot of people just go through the life working for the weekend, as the song says.
Yeah, exactly.
But if you have things that you're passionate about, that you're working for, that, you know, re-examining it and finding it again seems to be the challenge we all go through in whatever profession over and over and over again.
Yeah, and I guess that's what it is. I went through that long kind of diatribe, but really it's...
No, it was a great diatribe.
But really that's what it is. You question the passion. You know, it's like... any commitment, you got to work on the passion too. You got to work to keep bring the passion back. Sometimes you have to say, well, maybe there are certain roles that when I play them, I begin to hate everything that I do. I hate it. Like, I have to say, roles that are really, really stereotypically kind of black female roles make me really not like what I do. And the reason why it makes me not like what I do is because I can't do what I do. I can't do it. You know, I went to school for 4 years, tens of thousands of dollars in student loans, because I wanted to learn technique. I wanted to transform. I wanted to, like Uta Hagen says, when you create a human being that's completely different from you, that has vulnerabilities and humanity, that is great work, and that's an actor. Well, that's why I went to school, and I just, those roles are maddening because I can't play the human being. I can't. I play one thing, you know, I have to get my voice right. I don't have to do any prep work. I just have to know how to play hard. And, you know, that makes me, it devalues me, in my opinion, as an artist. And it makes me want to skip out, tell you the truth.
So do you find it getting easier to find scripts and things and projects that
No, I don't. No, I don't think it's easier.
Theater and film are the same difference?
Theater is a lot better.
A lot easier,
a lot better than TV and film, but absolutely not. You know, I'm just being honest. I'm not being trying to be negative.
No, no, no.
I hope that it's going to get better. You know, people throw Obama out there a lot as a kind of reason that it may get better, which I'll accept. I'll accept anything at this point. But no, it's not getting any better. I don't see any... very, very, very few complicated and varied roles out there for African Americans, probably in general, but more specifically African American women. I think that we're seeing...
Women in general, I think, also.
Women in general, absolutely. But I think I think Caucasian women fare better. They just simply do. I mean, that's just... they just do.
Yeah.
Although they are challenged, too.
Yeah.
You know. Not everyone is drinking from the same filthy pond. I mean, we're all drinking from it, but some drink a little bit deeper.
Yeah.
You know, that's how I say it. You know, some people are just a little bit more worse off, even though a lot of us may be worse off.
Right.
So in this case, No, I think we're seen as almost masculine in nature, mm-hmm. tell you the truth, or overly sexualized, right. or just archetypal, and metaphoric. Mm-hmm. You know, that where, you know, they throw us in a movie for an effect, mm-hmm. rather than to explore who we really are. Now, you know, it's what it is, but at the same time, what it does for the African-American actress is it devalues you. Mm-hmm. Why do you need an actor to do that? I mean, you could get Joe Schmo from the street and, you know, primp him up and put him in front of the camera and just have him go for it, you know? And so you feel like there is no craft when it comes to, well, you don't feel like there's a craft when it comes to acting anyway. I think it's craft that's kind of crapped on. But really, as a black actor, you feel like, why should there even be a craft? Mm-hmm. You know? I mean, the work is... The writing itself is substandard for us.
Mm-hmm. Well, so start with substandard with, you know, the 80% of it's not very good to begin with.
Yeah, exactly.
And then start, you know, narrowing it down to people who actually want to do the job and
exactly.
who can do the job. And then, mm-hmm. you know, it gets narrower and narrower. And they always are looking for the next girl who's 23 and, you know, and is
absolutely
not really necessarily a very good actress.
Well, absolutely. And, I mean... And, you know, those rules don't even apply to my category, mm-hmm. youth and beauty. And
well, it's been nice to actually, it was, you know, I saw you in The View and I saw you last night. And, mm-hmm. you know, it was kind of nice to see you glammed up because I'm used to you in roles that are kind of,
yeah,
you know.
They break me down. They break me down. You know what? I really figured it out, too. I thought to myself, I'm looking at myself on screen sometimes really broke down. Mm-hmm. And I thought to myself, see, this is where I'm full of shit, too. This is where I'm full of shit, because I thought to myself, oh, man, that's why I went to school, because I believe in a craft. That's why I could put my vanity aside and I can look bad on screen. I've discovered that it's kind of easier for me to look bad than look good. I'm more terrified of trying to put makeup on mm-hmm. and being kind of judged and held up against... The rest, the Halle Berrys and the Angela Bassetts, that's more terrifying to me. Mm-hmm. I had one friend who came to my house. She was selling me jewelry, an actress friend mm-hmm. of mine. And she said, you know, Bi, I got offered a role in Canada, and it was written for a black actress. It was a great role, complicated. Oh, I was so happy to get it. And it was an attractive woman I had to play, too. And I got up, she was playing, I think it was a cop, though, mm-hmm. a cop or something like that. And she said, so I went up and I played her. And I was kind of hardcore, played her strong or whatever. And the director looked at me and said, you know, can you lighten her up? Can you lighten her up and make her maybe sexier and, you know, maybe show some vulnerability? Mm-hmm. And she was so shocked. Because she's always told, like me, strong, sassy. She was so shocked, she said, that she realized she didn't even know how to do it. Hmm. And that's kind of how I feel. Yeah. You know, I get to the, you know, that's why I'm saying I'm full of shit. Because I'm saying I want the complicated roles. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to be a little sexier, quirkier, you know, mm-hmm. not so strong, all of that. But I've been doing this so long, I've accepted it so long, the kind of stereotypical roles, mm-hmm. that I think if the other came my way, it would throw me a little bit. Mm-hmm. I think that I would need some time to orient, you know, mm-hmm. myself, you know, and to figure out how to do that. Mm-hmm. Because in my mind is the stamp of the metaphor. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like anything in life. It's like if someone tells you who you are long enough, you accept it. You know, it's mm-hmm. like the abused child saying, you're no good, you're no good, you're freaking no good. At some point, you're going to think you're no good. Well, you know, as a black woman, you're told, you know, you're not as attractive, you're strong, you know, and I don't really see black women like that. So you accept it. You really do. You accept it. So even when you're given a character like Mrs. Miller, you're like, I don't know if I... she's too weak. And she is what she is, right? But, you know, the stamp is in my head.
Well, Mrs. Miller's a fascinating character. I've had a few conversations with a few different people involved with the movie, who go nameless, I guess, at the moment. But, you know, about whether Mrs. Miller is in some way a victim in this whole story as well. Because that's how I saw it.
Absolutely.
Huh?
Yeah.
I mean, to me, ultimately, I felt almost like she was the nun's victim, whose name I'm forgetting, whose character name I'm forgetting at the moment, but that she, that there was such a passion to get to the priest.
Yeah, exactly.
That she was willing to bring doubt on a level to Mrs. Miller that was actually very contemptuous, I thought. I thought it was evil in a way.
Yeah, exactly.
That she was willing to make somebody doubt their priest.
Yeah, exactly.
About molesting her child.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of horrifying.
It's kind of horrifying. You know, I have to say that the character for me was released when I didn't think of any of that.
Mm-hmm.
None of it. I let it all go. I let it all go, whether she was a victim or whether she was strong or what she meant or all of that. Mm-hmm. When I let it all go. And I approached her like a therapist would approach a patient.
Hmm.
Who is this human being? And that's it. And I'll tell you, the revelation that I made was that all of them are completely the same.
Hmm.
Sister Aloysius, Father Flynn, Sister James, Mrs. Miller, they're all the same. They're all victim of their circumstances. Which is, you know, you are bred to be who your parents are, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And you follow what you've been taught and what you know in life. Circumstances are placed on you by culture, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether what in 64, what it meant to be a woman, the choices you had as a woman, the choices you had as a black woman. You know, Mrs. Miller probably grew up without a father, you know, whatever. And then you become the adult you become based on your childhood,
mm-hmm.
memories or whatever. And I think they're all just flawed human beings doing what they think is right. Sister Aloysius is fighting for what she thinks is right. I'm fighting for what I think is right.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm probably screwed up in your opinion, not my opinion, about where I arrive at. And she's screwed up with her opinion, probably, maybe, not in my opinion, right. You know, as Viola,
mm-hmm.
and where she arrives at. That's human. Same with Father Flynn. Is he flawed for hugging students? And what has he done?
Mm-hmm.
People are complicated. No one is necessarily just right or wrong or just victim or hero. We're all of those things
mm-hmm.
at any given time. And none of those things at any given time. And that's how I saw them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, perception mm-hmm. sees her as victim or hero, her as right or wrong, him as right or wrong. That's perception.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not the actual person. The person is just being human.
Mm-hmm.
When you need something in life, you fight to feed it. That's what they say in acting. If
mm-hmm.
you need love, then you go out there and you get love through what? Sex,
mm-hmm.
binging, humor.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they teach you in acting, that we're all motivated by a need, all mm-hmm. of us, you know, and what we want is based on what we need.
Mm-hmm.
And I see them all being the same, actually.
Yeah.
And I think that John Patrick Shanley presented all of us in different bodies. You know, some of us with breasts,
mm-hmm.
some of us with penises, and others with dark skin,
mm-hmm.
just to confuse you.
Well,
but really, we're really all the same.
What's the Rorschach test of it? I think that's what's fascinating about the play and the movie is that,
yeah.
you know, what you bring to the theater, what you bring to the movie theater is a lot of what you get out of it, a lot of what you take away.
Well, that's why they say that acting or theater is a collaborative art. TV film is a collaborative art. Mm-hmm. And people forget that. You know, as a painter, you can go into a room by yourself and close the door and you can create masterpieces, right? Mm-hmm. But in TV film, theater, it requires a mixture of all art forms. Mm-hmm. The actor, the writer, the director. But final piece of the puzzle, though, the final piece of the puzzle is the audience. It requires you mm-hmm. and your perception, and it requires you to have a certain aesthetic, a certain knowledge right. of how all of it is put together. Mm-hmm. And hopefully an open mind, but you know, you don't get that. But.
Well, it's funny because talking to John about it was a lot of the conversation was about how much he respects the audience and that, you know, for him, that audience is the arbiter, even though he has all the power of the playwright in the theater in particular, mm-hmm. that it still comes down to, you know, seeing that show in front of an audience and seeing what they think is funny or sad or horrifying or great.
Absolutely.
And feeling that, and that you can't, there's no point in loving it yourself if nobody else is getting it.
Oh, absolutely. Although a lot of us are legends in our own mind, so, you know, I think it happens a lot. My friend told me a story, and it was a very short story, but it was great. I thought, this is great. She's a college professor of mine. She said she was running on a track one day, early in the morning running, and she saw a black woman. Not that she had, I don't know why I mentioned she was a black woman. But anyway, the woman said, oh, can I run with you? And she said, oh, yeah, we can run together. And they had a conversation about, you know, it's just an exchange. And mm-hmm. the woman said, so what do you do? And my friend said, you know what? I'm a college professor, but, you know, I'm also a playwright. I write plays. Mm-hmm. And the woman stopped and she said, oh, my, that is fantastic. I love the theater. So, you know, I love the theater, and just engaged in conversation mm-hmm. and talked. And then she said, but you know what? I stopped going to the theater many years ago. And my friend asked her why. And she said she stopped going to the theater, she said, because she's like, I'm not articulate. But I started leaving the theater feeling like my son had just died. Mm-hmm. And she said, I don't know, you know, I don't have the words to describe it, but mm-hmm. I kind of feel like when you go to the theater, you should feel like you do when you go to church. You should feel like you've been inspired, mm-hmm. you know, like you've been convicted. She's like, but maybe I don't know anything, but that's kind of how I feel. And I think mm-hmm. that's the goal, but mm-hmm. I think that a lot of times we fall short because we become whores, and we just want to kind of have a very surface kind of effect, and we want people to like us, and we mm-hmm. want just entertainment. But I think that what John did with this is, I think he's convicted people. Mm-hmm. That I think it's kind of forced people to look at their judgment and their perceptions in a different way, is what I think.
I think people really like walking out of a theater or movie theater and thinking. And actually, you know, I think they also like to be entertained and distracted mm-hmm. and all of that. But I also think that they do, when it's something that they really do chew on, that it sticks with them, and 2-3 days later it's still kind of gnawing in the back of their head. And
absolutely.
You know, you remember those moments.
Yeah. Yeah, that's when it's at its best.
Yeah.
That's actually when I say, I love what I do. I love it, because then it becomes, it's full of shit probably, but it becomes important, you know? Mm-hmm.
So seeing this performance for the first time, when you saw, I assume you've seen the film, and I assume you've seen the performance, so what was that moment? Is that moment always shocking to you when you...
Shocking.
Yeah. You know?
Yeah,
are you comfortable seeing yourself
Never.
On film? Does it get comfortable? Do you watch now
Never.
Movies 15 years ago and go,
no.
okay, now I got it?
Never. I never get comfortable. You know, I never get comfortable.
And do you feel at peace with the work? I mean, do you feel like, okay, I've got it as an actor now, I know what I'm doing?
That's a hard one, you know? That's a hard one. That's a hard one. Certain roles I feel pretty good about. And it's interesting that most of them are on the stage because I don't have to look at them. But others, I just, you know what it feels like? It feels like if I say that, I'm done. And I don't want to be done yet. I'm always trying to tweak. And then you know what happens when you watch yourself? Other things come into play. You know, like ego, which is, oh, my lips are really big, my nose is full. Those things that have nothing to do with the work, you know, those things come in. And it clouds your judgment, which is why I probably like the work I've done on stage better, because I don't have to watch myself. How I watch myself is the audience's reaction, which I love, you know.
So are you aware of the intensity, the incredible intensity that you bring and are able to transpose over into a camera in so many of your pieces of work? I mean, the amount of emotional energy that you push through a camera, even in a role like Mrs. Miller, for instance, you don't have a whole lot of screen time, but you, it's all out there.
Yeah.
Is it different than theater that way, or is it... Do you know that you have that skill? Or are you just working?
You know, sometimes I do. Sometimes I do. You know what I'll say? I'll say I'm satisfied with my performance in doubt. And when I see my performance in doubt or Antoine Fisher, I think, okay, I know that's what people see me as. I guess that's where my power is. That's a very difficult question, because what you like about me is what I think is okay. What you may like about me is sometimes what I wish were different. In school, they would just tell me all the time to lighten up. You know, they wanted to see me sexy and light and airy. You know, Viola, we know you could do that. And that's what I wanted to be, you know. Or, you know, when I was in school, every time I answered the phone, people thought I was a guy. So I always wanted to have a higher voice. But then people say, oh, we love your voice, Viola. And, you know, we love the fact that you can move us to tears. And those are things that I'm like, oh, it's okay. But I want to kind of be a little cuter, a little quirkier. You know,
but it's apparent that you are. That's the thing that's so fascinating about seeing you this last through this process, is that you are been very funny and very charming and lovely, and you know, you can see you in the, you know, musical singing and dancing, and you know.
But what would you do with me in a script?
Well, I'd have to think of a whole script, but I mean, I would love to see. I would. To me, it's the thing where a director, and Soderbergh is actually, you know, the kind of guy who has the guts to do it a lot of the time. To just take an actor who knows how to act and to bring something special and let him do something that's not exactly the same thing we're used to seeing. Those are such revelatory moments.
I think that they're revelatory moments too. You know, I've seen myself, you know, I'm the geek. When have you ever seen a black geek? A black female kind of middle-aged geek.
And you're funny.
Oh, well, thank you.
If you get you doing comedies, you get to be with the Farrelly Brothers.
You know, I think I'm shy. You know, I'm kind of shy. At the same time, I could be a little bawdy, I think. And so I'm a shy, bawdy, geeky, black, middle-aged woman.
Yeah.
You know, where have you seen that?